If you're struggling with chemistry, this playlist is for you. It's Medicosis Perfectionalis, and the playlist is called Chemistry Quick Review. In previous videos, we talked about the periodic table of the elements. We talked about the shells of the electrons. Today, we'll talk about the subshells and the orbitals, as well as electron configuration. What are the subshells? We have the S subshell, P subshell, D subshell, and the F subshell. As for the orbitals, please remember that each orbital can carry a maximum number of 2 electrons only. I hope that you watch the videos in this chemistry quick review playlist in order for maximum understanding and retention, especially the last video on electron shells. As you may recall, the first shell of electrons has a principal quantum number of 1, the second has number 2, and the third has principal quantum number 3. Energy increases as you go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, etc. So as you go farther away from the nucleus, the energy increases, which means you should fill the low energy shells before the high energy ones. Nucleus is in the middle, electrons are around it. When you become a cation, it means that you lost electrons. Sometimes you lose an entire shell of electrons, like sodium, for example. Sodium will lose shell number 3 to become Na plus 1. And as you lose a shell, you shrink in size. That's why cations are smaller in size, followed by a neutral atom, but anions are big because we're gaining more electrons. All things being equal, of course. Let's look at sodium, for example. How many shells do we have? Look at this number, the number of the period. We have 3 shells. And how many electrons exist in the outermost or valence shell? You look here, it's called group 1. So only 1 electron in the outermost shell. Let's try oxygen. How many shells? Well, 2 shells. How many electrons in the outermost shell? 6 electrons. So let's put everything together. The substance or matter includes element, which is the simplest form of matter. Elements usually exist as molecules. Molecules are made of atoms. The atom is made of a nucleus centrally and electrons peripherally. The electrons are organized in orbits or shells, followed by suborbits or subshells. Underneath, we have orbitals. Orbitals or shells, that's the principal quantum number. First orbit, second orbit, third orbit, fourth orbit, etc. Suborbits or subshells are the S subshell, P subshell, D subshell, and F subshell. And each orbital can carry a maximum number of 2 electrons. If I am the first electron shells or orbit, what's the maximum number of electrons allowed in the shell? Easy. The N equals 1 in this case, because I'm talking about the first shell. 1 raised to the second power is 1, multiplied by 2 is 2. So the maximum number of electrons here is 2. How about the second shell? 2 raised to the second power is 4, times 2 is 8. So the maximum number of electrons allowed in the second shell is 8. In 3, plug in 3 here, you get a total of 18 maximum number of electrons. If you want to know more about the change in energy, E final minus E initial, please refer to video number 12 titled Electron Shells. So again, the first shell has a maximum number of 2 electrons. Second shell, 8 electrons maximum. Third, 18. 4, 32. Fifth, you get the point. That was the shells. How about the subshells? The subshells or suborbits are S, P, D, and F. S subshell has a maximum number of 1 orbital. And since each orbital can carry a maximum number of 2 electrons, you can say that the S subshell has a maximum number of 2 electrons. How about the P subshell? Maximum number of orbitals? 3. And then each orbital can carry a maximum number of 2 electrons. 3 times 2 is 6 electrons maximum. D subshell has 5 orbitals. Each orbital has 2 electrons maximum. 5 times 2 is 10 electrons. How about the F subshell? It has a maximum number of orbitals of 7. 7 times 2 is 14 electrons maximum. So there you go again. S subshell, 1 orbital. Each orbital can carry a maximum number of 2 electrons. 1 times 2 is 2. How about the P subshell? It has 3 orbitals, 3 times 2 is 6, and then 5 times 2 is 10, and then 7 times 2 is 14. Now let me give you something theoretical. This does not exist. Suppose that we have a G subshell after the F. How many maximum number of orbitals can we have inside the G subshell? Answer is 9.
Why? How did it happen?
Look at the pattern, please. 1, and then became 3, which means we added 2. The 3 became 5. We added 2. The 5 became 7. We added 2. So the 7 becomes 9. Moreover, how many maximum number of electrons are allowed in the G theoretical hypothetical subshell? Answer, 9 times 2 is 18. Follow the pattern. 2 plus 4 is 6. 6 plus 4 is 10. 10 plus 4 is 14. 14 plus 4 is 18. So here, each time we're adding 2 orbitals. And here, each time we're adding 4 extra electrons. This is very important to understand. Please pause and review. Get a pen and paper and draw everything here without looking at my slide. The number of the period tells you the outermost shell. So, potassium has 4 electron shells. Hydrogen only has 1. Lithium has 2. The electron configuration of aluminum involves 3 shells of electrons because it's in period number 3. So here is the number of the period in the periodic table. In the first period, we only have 1 shell. In this one shell, the maximum number of electrons allowed is 2. The first shell only has 1 subshell, and this is the S subshell. How about the second shell? It has 2. See? 2 and 2. What are these 2 subshells? The S subshell and the P subshell. The third shell has 3 subshells. The fourth shell has 4 subshells. The S subshell only has 1 orbital, if you remember, which means the maximum number of electrons is 2. How about here? We have S and P. The S subshell has 1 orbital, maximum number 2 electrons. The P subshell has 3 orbitals. Each one can carry a maximum of 2 electrons, which means 6. 2 electrons in the S subshell plus 6 electrons in the P subshell total equals 8 electrons. Next, here in the third shell, I have S subshell, P subshell, D subshell. S subshell has 1 orbital, meaning 2 maximum electrons. P subshell has 3 orbitals, meaning 6 electrons maximum. The D subshell has 5, meaning 10 electrons maximum. 2 plus 6 plus 10 equals 18, maximum number of electrons, and so on and so forth. Here is the lovely periodic table. Get your pencil and write S subshell here, P subshell here, D subshell here, and the F subshell here. How should we write the electron configuration? In what order? In the order of energy, from low energy to high energy. As you go downstairs, the energy increases. As you go to the right, the energy increases. So how do we do it? How do we write the electron configuration? From low energy to high energy. The lowest energy is 1s. This is the S subshell, which belongs to the first shell. After 1s, you have 2s. After 2s, 2p. Then 3s. Then 3p. And then 4s. And then 3d. 4p. 5s. 4d. 5p. 6s. 4f, as in F me. 5d. 6p. 6s. 5f. 6D, 7P, etc., etc., etc.
Why are we going through this weird order?
From low energy to high energy. Nature loves the low energy states because they are easier to maintain.
Do you have a mnemonic for this?
Yes, my lovely Egyptian teacher came up with this crazy acronym. In the Arabic Egyptian dialect, it might make some sense. It goes like this. SS, PES, PES. DPS, DPS, FDPS. Again, SS, PES, PES, DPS, DPS, FDPS, as in F me. You gotta end up on a high note. F me, FDPS. So let's practice. What's the electron configuration for the following atoms? Hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, and boron. Can you pause and answer this yourself? Let's go. Go to the periodic table. Hydrogen is element number 1, which means we only have 1 electron to play with because the atomic number is 1. If the atomic number is 1, it means that hydrogen atom has 1 electron. So it's just this. 1s1. Next, helium. How many electrons? 2. So 1s2. Here's the number of the shell. Here is the subshell, and we have 2 electrons in the s subshell in the first shell. Next, lithium. I have 3 electrons. The first 2, just like helium. After this, what do I do? Look at the mnemonic. After s, there is also s. But this s belonged to the first shell. However, this s belongs to the second shell of electrons. So 1s2, 2s1. Total, 2 plus 1 equals 3 electrons. Brilliant. Beryllium, 4 electrons total, 1s2, 2s2, add them, 2 plus 2 is 4, so I know that I answered this correctly. And then boron, 5 electrons, 1s2, 2s2. Can I add the last electron here? No, because the s subshell has a maximum capacity of 2 electrons, because the s subshell only has 1 orbital, and each orbital carries 2 electrons. So I'm satisfied. I am full. What do I do? Go to the mnemonic. After S and S, what do you go to? P. P subshell of which shell? Of the second shell. Because the second shell carries 2 subshells. The S subshell and the P subshell. 2 plus 2 is 4, so I need 1. I'll put that 1 here. So it's 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. When you add these electrons together, you get 5. Now let's look at lithium again. 1s2, 2s1. What was the last thing? 2s1, the s subshell. And let's look at lithium here. Oh, it's in the s subshell category. How about boron? It was 1s2, 2s2, 2P1, yes, because it's in the P subshell category. It makes perfect sense. You can download these doozy handwritten notes on my website, medicosisperfectionalis.com. How many electrons does helium have? Answer, 2 electrons. So what's the electron configuration of helium? 1s2, and I'm done. Okay, so lithium could be written as 1s2, 2s1, or helium, i.e. the 1s2, add to that 2s1. So you can write it like this, or write lithium like this, meaning that lithium has 1 extra electron in addition to what helium has. So these are different ways to write the electron configuration of lithium. If you do it just by the shells, without the subshells, so 3 electrons, 2 here and 1 here. Because the maximum number of electrons in the first shell is 2. In the second shell, it's 8. So we still have enough space. Let's do it by the subshells. We have 3 electrons, 1s2, 2s1. The s subshell has 1 orbital. And this s subshell has 1 orbital. Put the 2 electrons here with opposite spins, clockwise and counterclockwise. Positive spin, negative spin, north, south. You can call it whatever you want to call it, but they have to be opposite. Otherwise, the negative electron will repel the negative electron and ruin everything. They cannot coexist together until they have opposite spins. How about this last loner? You put it right here. So when I say 1s2, this one is the first quantum number. That's the number of the shell. How about this s? That's the name of the subshell. How about this 2? It's the number of the electrons in the s subshell. Next, can you write the electron configuration of these neutral atoms? Please pause and try to answer this yourself. Let's go. Carbon. Look at the atomic number in the periodic table. 6. Okay, 6 electrons. 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Nitrogen, 7. 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Let's check the answer. 2 plus 2 is 4, plus 3 is 7. Bingo. Oxygen is 8. 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. And then fluorine is number 9. 1s2, 2s2, 2p5. Neon. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. Do not forget the mnemonic. SS, PES, PES, DPS, DPS, FDPS. How about the electron configuration of scandium, which is number 21 in the periodic table? Here is how you do it. We have 21 electrons. Remember the mnemonic. SS. So let's go. 1s2, 2s2. After this, P. 2p6. How many electrons so far? 10. Oh, I still have 11 electrons to put. So what should I go after the P? S. Oh, 3s2. Wonderful. And then after this, you go to the P. 3p6. Let's count. 2 plus 2 is 4 plus 6 is 10. Plus 8 is 18. I still have extra 3 electrons. Where should I go next? You should go to 4s but it can only carry 2. Then after the S, what do you go to? I go to 3D and I put the last electron here. Go back to the periodic table. Where did we put the D? We put it in the middle of the periodic table. And you'll find scandium right there in the D category. Because the last subshell that we filled in scandium was that D subshell. That's why we put the scandium in the D group in the periodic table. Which row, which period does scandium belong to? Answer the fourth row, or period number 4. And that's why the maximum number of a shell that you'll find here is number 4. That's the top. Because scandium is in the fourth row of the periodic table. The number of the period corresponds with the number of the outermost shell. Let's answer the question of the previous video. Draw the Lewis dot structure for magnesium fluoride. Please pause and try to answer this yourself. Let's go. Magnesium fluoride. It ends in ide. What do you think this is? Is this an element, a molecule, an ion, a polyatomic ion, or a compound? Answer, this is a compound because it ends in ide. Magnesium fluoride. So I know that I have the magnesium element and the fluorine element in this compound. So the first order of business is to draw the symbol for the magnesium element and for the fluorine element. Let's go. After this, ask yourself, is magnesium a metal or a non-metal? Answer, it's a metal. How about fluorine? Non-metal. Between metal and non-metal, what's the type of the bond? Usually ionic bond. Ionic! So we'll have a positive ion and a negative ion. Of course, you know that metals tend to form positive ions, but non-metals tend to form negative ions. Look at your periodic table. Which group is magnesium in? If you say group 2A, you're absolutely correct. Which means each magnesium atom needs to lose 2 electrons to become a positive 2 magnesium ion, or a positive 2 cation. Now let's look at fluorine in the periodic table. It belongs to group 17, meaning it has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. To achieve the octet, fluorine needs an extra electron, so it is just 1 negative. It will gain an electron to achieve the octet. But now we have a dilemma. Magnesium is giving away 2 electrons, but fluorine is accepting only 1, meaning that you will need 2 fluorine atoms. Next, let's draw the dots, i.e. the electrons. Let's go. Magnesium. Before it was ionized, just go back to the good old neutral magnesium. How many electrons does it have in the outermost shell? Answer, only 2. So just like this. Now magnesium will lose 2 electrons, which means you should remove your dots, like this. So the first part is done. Magnesium, 2 plus, brackets, everything is good. Next, fluorine. Before it was ionized, it used to have 7 electrons in the outermost shell. So let's draw 7 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Then the fluorine will gain an extra electron. So there you go, 8. And when you gain a negative, you become negative 1. And since we need 2 fluorine atoms, the answer looks like this. Magnesium, 2 plus, and then fluorine minus, and 2 right here.
Is there another way to draw the Lewis dot structure for magnesium fluoride?
Absolutely. You can draw it like this. Here is magnesium, close the parentheses, 2 plus. And then what? You can add a negative fluorine right here with a negative sign. And don't forget the 8 electrons, 8 dots. And the other fluorine right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Close, negative. Or you can even answer it in this manner. Here is magnesium, 2 plus, and then 2 fluorine atoms, just like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, minus 1. You can answer it like this, or like this. All of them are correct. Question of the day. What's the electron configuration of the following neutral atoms? Please pause. Let me know your answers in the comment section. You will find the answer key in the next video, which will be titled The Pauli Principle, Hund's Rule, Octet Rule, and the Aufbau Principle. I do not just teach chemistry. I also teach biochemistry, biology, pharmacology, medicine, etc. Are you struggling with these graphs of elimination and the half-life of elimination, pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, etc.? Download my general pharmacology course at medicosisperfectionalist.com to master these topics so that you can help your future patient. There are more than 1,500 free videos on this channel, plus 300 premium videos that you can access right now by clicking the join button and subscribing to the highest tier. Smash like, subscribe, hit the bell, support my channel here or here, go to my website to download my notes, courses, or cases, or if you'd like me to personally tutor you. Be safe, stay happy, study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense.